Okay, so I want to talk about INH monoresist. Oh, not this one.
Quite a few, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, sorry.
Okay.
Oh, there we go. More up. There we go. Oh, maybe just, yeah, that's great.
So, objective today. So, just want to make sure you identify the impact of INH monoresistant TB on clinical outcomes to appropriately treat patients and describe the new WHO guidelines. Okay, next, please. I can do this. Okay, so I'm going to start off with a case. 52-year-old man with type 2 diabetes. He's coughing for 2 weeks, lost about 10 pounds. His AFP smear is 3+. Expert showed MTB complex, detected no RPOB mutation, likely rifampin susceptible. X-rays shows left upper lobe opacity right here, consistent with active pulmonary tuberculosis. He was placed on daily wipe. And then 3 weeks into TB treatment, results of the testing came back and it says rifampin PCA with ethambutol susceptible, but INH resistance at the 0.1 microgram. Testing at the higher INH level is pending. His cough improved, gained weight. Smear is now 1+ from 3+. So what would you do? So here's a poll, right? So with the 0.1 microgram resistance, would you continue daily, you know, 4 drugs? Or would you change INH to higher dose 3 times a week and continue daily rifampin PCA ethambutol? Or add levofloxacin and then continue 4 drugs, essentially 5 drugs. Or stop INH and continue daily ethambutol PCA rifampin. Or the last option, stop INH, add levofloxacin, and then continue daily rifampin PCA ethambutol. Okay, what's your favorite? What would you do?
So before us, we see INH resistant at 0.1 micrograms per milliliter. And so our choices are continue HRZE, change INH high dose 3 times weekly and continue daily HRZE, oh sorry, RZE. Or the third one, add levo and continue with HRZE plus levo, drop INH. What? How many do we have so far? Yeah? 11.
Okay, interesting. So we have about half of people will drop INH and add levo plus 3 other drugs. And then there are a few other options. Interestingly, nobody picked the high dose isoniazid. You know, about maybe 25 years ago when I started TB, my mentor told me to do higher dose. So many, many years ago, people thought that, you know, high dose INH can overcome low level INH resistance. But again, that was many years ago. And also, I don't know if you are aware, the ATS CDC guidance, treatment guidelines, before, not this time, published in 2002 or something. So that did say, you can do 4 drugs, you know, standard 4 drugs for 6 months. Anyhow, so that's what I was going to say. 2002 treatment guidelines, they used to say, INH with monoresistance, you can do rifampin PCA ethambutol for 6 months. And it does say quinolone may change the regimen for patients with extensive disease. So that's what it used to say. So I'm going to ask you more questions. I know there's no right or wrong answer here yet. So sputum converted it to 4 weeks. Now at 8 weeks of TB treatment, he's feeling a lot better, gained 15 pounds. Lab now says INH resistance at the even higher level, 1 1 microgram per ml. Is it microgram? I think so. What would you do now? I think the same thing. Do you want to do revamping PZ ethambutol levofloxacin, or do you want to do daily revamping PZ ethambutol levo but change to 3 times a week? Do you want to stop at this point at 2 months? Stop PZA, continue daily revamping ethambutol levo, or stop again PZA because of 2 months, and then change daily ethambutol levo to 3 times a week. What would you do?
Wait, Maza, so you assume we all added levo?
Yeah, that's right. So, you know, because half of people wanted to add levo, right? So I predicted this. So I have a crystal ball. Anyhow, I must say, so now daily drugs, pumping PZA, ethambutol levo, that's half of the people wanted to do. With that, then do you want to continue daily, change to 3 times a week, or do you want to drop PZA, or do you want to even drop PZA and change to 3 times a week? What would you like to do? Okay, so now, many people, so overwhelming 77% wants to do daily 4 jars. There's maybe quarter people, you know, wants to drop PZA and then continue daily with rifampin ethambutol levofloxacin. So this is interesting. Okay, let's move on to the next. So why are we talking about INH mono-resistant TB? It turns out 8% of TB cases worldwide are INH mono-resistant. And then in the guide, so there's a WHO guidance came out this year, I think, right? And it states with the isoniazid mono-resistance, higher treatment failure, 11% versus 1% if it's not, and higher relapse rate, 10% versus 5%. And it does say the standardized empiric TB treatment contributes to higher rates of acquired drug resistance, 8% versus 0.3%. So when I read this, I didn't believe this. Because it's not my impression that INH mono-resistant TB has an 11% treatment failure or 10% relapse. It doesn't. I'm not observing that. So I looked at the data, right? And then here's what the information says. So the analysis is based on WHO regimens. So as you may be aware, there are 2 WHO regimens. One is to apply this for new TB cases versus WHO retreatment regimen. So WHO new patient regimen is, you know, the standard 4 drugs for the first 2 months, followed by INH and revamping for 4 months. Or if it's retreatment, the recommendation, so this is a, you know, a meta-analysis from the old studies. So they use a 5 drugs, 4 drugs plus streptomycin upfront for the first 2 months, and then INH revamping PZA ethambutol for 1 month, and then drop down to INH revamping ethambutol for 5 months. So that's total of 8 months. So if you use this regimen, of course, you know, if it's INH mono-resistant, in terms of treatment failure, people don't get cured for the standardized 4 drugs for 2 months followed by INH revamping, because the continuation phase, it is INH resistant. So that's where 11% came from. And then with the WHO retreatment regimen, somehow, even with this 8-month regimen with the multiple drugs in it, it wasn't good enough, right? So the treatment failure was 6%. And if you carefully look at this regimen, the patient received only 3 months of PGA. First 2 months plus 1 month. So 3 months of PGA, right, was not good for INH resistant TB. And then if somebody gave a revamping PGA, ethambutol 3 drugs, treatment failure rate was really low. Right? So that's good. And then if you look at the relapse, similar thing, right? The standardized 4 drugs for 2 months, followed by INH pumping for 4 months, right? Many people relapsed, right? Because of INH resistance. Expanded regimen for 8 months. So this one, you didn't see the difference in relapse between INH resistant TB versus pan sensitive TB. And then if you do revamping PGA ethambutol for 6 to 9 months, there's not much difference. Acquired drug resistance, yes, you know, because of isoniazid monoresistance, the standard regimen gave you 8% of acquired resistance. The reason is, you know, many parts of the world, they do not do sensitivity testing. They just provide this treatment, and for the study sake, they look at, you know, the drug resistance pattern. So, you know, so this happens, right? And if it's retreatment regimen, INH resistant TB, about 3% acquired drug resistance. And then, revamping PGA ethambutol, there's a minimum difference between INH resistant and pan-sensitive TB. All right, so based on this information, although it wasn't drastic as we thought, the duration that, you know, HRZE, there was no statistical difference in the treatment outcomes of patients receiving 6 months of revamping ethambutol PGA and those receiving more than 6 months. And the treatment success rates were higher when quinolone were used, added to revamping ethambutol PGA. And this led to the recommendation from WHO. So now it says, in patients with confirmed revamping susceptible INH resistant TB, treatment with the revamping ethambutol PGA and Levo is recommended for a duration of 6 months. And then duration of the treatment, now what they say is until 6 months of levofloxacin has been given. So in the past, you know, we're okay with the 6 months of revamping PGA ethambutol, and what we are learning here is even if the patient got the 3 drugs plus isoniazid for the first several weeks, we cannot give them a credit, right? So we have to start counting when levofloxacin was added. And side note, I think that this is more about lab issue. You know, we do have MDDR, you know, the molecular-based resistance. If it says INHA mutation, it suggests low isoniazid resistance and ethambutol resistance. And the CATG mutation, it indicates a high level INH resistance. Take home message, WHO guidance on treatment of INH monoresistant TB is to drop INH, as you guys said, and add levofloxacin, and then give full 6 months of revamping PGA ethambutol plus levofloxacin. So that's a take-home message. Any questions about INH monoresistant TB? So there's some changes in the recommendation compared to the previous U.S. guidance. And my understanding is that U.S. drug resistance guidance is coming out soon, and it's going to be very similar to what the WHO would say.